My dear viewers and followers, I am Priyanka from Nowwards, and today onwards, we are going to speak something different and new about Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee's journey of life, his dedication to form a better India, and as a nationalist hero. As per our research collected and acquired informations from various sources, so we will try to enter the detail of his life bit by bit.
This is Robert Charles, governing body member for Dr. Shyama Prasad Enlightenment Federation. Today we are going to speak about the main objectives of Dr. Shyama Prasad Enlightenment Federation. So basically, when we talk about our objectives, our main work is regarding the study and research about the life of Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, his activities and teachings. We arrange and organize lectures, debates, discussion, congress, seminars for the diffusion of knowledge about the activities of Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee.
July 1901, Calcutta. Born Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee in a Bengali Hindu Brahmin family. Mother Jogomaya Devi. 1906, enrolled in Bhavanapur's Mitra Institution. Later, his school teachers favorably described his behavior. Father Ashutosh Mukherjee, judge of the High Court of Calcutta, also was a Vice Chancellor of the University of Calcutta.
The year 1919, he stood first in the inter-arts examination of the university. In spite of having passed his BA with English in the year 1921 with honors, he took up Bengali as a subject for his MA degree, keeping in accordance to his father's insistence of placing and to give a position to the Indian vernacular language its true and real place in the university education, which was still then alone dominated by the British language, English, means a foreign language. Coming to his personal life, in between his MA degree, in the month of April of the year 1922, he got married to Sudha Devi at a very early age. Though his married life was very short period, in the year 1934, she passed away. But Shyama Prasad decided not to marry again. The sudden, untimely and unexpected death of his father, Sir Ashutosh Mukherjee, in the year 1923, began a new chapter of his life, which we can see in his words. It is known that he had a closer insight of his father's educational plans and policies, who was also a vice chancellor. It is also known that he was assisting his father from the student days. In the year 1924, he was elected to the University Senate and Syndicate and represented the Bengal Legislative Council as a Congress candidate. Though in the year 1930, he resigned his seat from the Legislative Council for the cause of the Congress boycotting the legislatures. But soon he re-entered the council with the view of safeguarding his university's interest. His main occupation remained to be servicing to the cause of education.
Shyama Prasad became the youngest vice chancellor in the year 1934 of the University of Calcutta. And this opened up the opportunities to place his aims and ideals regarding the education of his people in practice. It was during his Vice Chancellorship that Rabindranath Tagore for the first time in the year 1937 delivered the university convocation address in Bengali, and which marked an end of the era of English language superiority over the Indian vernacular language. Rabindranath Tagore also constructed poem on the foundation day of the university, and he wrote poem on Africa. His delivered speech in Bengali on 17th of February 1937 remains to be an exception, as it is for the first time that a non-official person was invited in the convocation of the university, that during the Vice Chancellorship of Shyama Prasad Mukherjee also requested Tagore to compose a song which could be adopted by the University of Calcutta as the university song. And for that, Tagore not only composed one but two songs. Latin, the second song, Shubho Karma Pathe Dharo Nirbhayo Gaan, was adopted by the University of Calcutta as the university song. Now we had presented to you all Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee as an educationist. But now we are going to enter into a new phase of his life, that is the political phase of his life. That we were trying to show you the political journey of his life as far as information we have gathered till now yet on base of that. Now, being a historical figure, a heroic figure, and a national icon, a nationalist hero, and an immensely talented scholar person who dedicated his life to the nation, even he died for the nation, we will try to present the life journey of such a scholar person to you all as per our gathered informations. Now, a point struck me very much, that is, in our school or college days, we didn't even hear any such name as Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, neither we were introduced by such any name. Though he was a great scholar person, a nationalist hero, a heroic figure of the nation. Now that is an astonishing fact, isn't it? So for this we need your immense support and love. Thank you.
Guys, based on the speech today I have delivered today, I have set up questions from you guys. My first question is, what is the role of Shyama Prasad Mukherjee in India's freedom and politics thereafter? Second, did Jinnah demand West Bengal and was it saved because of Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee? Third, how important is Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee in the history of West Bengal? Fourth, what are your views about Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee? Fifth, is it true that India retained Kolkata during partition due to Shyama Prasad Mukherjee? Sixth, who was Shyama Prasad and what were his contribution in the Indian freedom movement? My last question, why did Shyama Prasad Mukherjee leave the INC, that is Indian National Congress? Thank you so much.
Introduction of the provincial part of the Government of Indian Act 1935 and the election of the provincial legislation in the year 1937 made a twist in the situation of the country. Shyama Prasad returned from the university constituency to the Bengal legislation, which afforded him with an opportunity to know the provincial autonomy from very close quarter. Now, in a house of 250 members, only 80 seats were for the Hindus, for which mostly the congressmen were returned, and the rest were divided between the Muslims and the British interest. And the Muslims further were divided into Muslim League and the Krishak Praja Party. But then Bengal could have got a non-Muslim League stable government if Congress could have joined the Krishak Praja Party. But that couldn't happen, so Congress were then handling both the in and outside of the legislatures, and that provoked Shyama Prasad to think afresh about his political constituency and its policy. On its formation of ministry, the Muslim League decided to strike at the educational structure. which was so assiduously built by Shyama Prasad and his father himself. Now, the National Congress policy of compromising with the Muslim League, even at its clear and vital national interest, was so unacceptable to his innate nationalism. And as he failed to persuade the National Congress policy of allowing the Muslim League of a safe spell of power, so he decided to go ahead all alone and topple the Muslim League ministry. He alone assembled together all the non-Congress Hindu forces in the legislature and made a coalition, a progressive coalition with the Krishak Praja Party under the leadership Fazlul Haq, and he himself became the finance minister of this coalition ministry. Thus, it made an establishment of his position as a practical and far-sighted political leader because of this ministry. The election took place in the year 1937, and the Congress Party emerged out to be as the single largest party, but it refused to form the government because of its policy of boycotting the legislatures. And the Krishak Praja Party, now with the Bengal Provincial Muslim League and by having support of several other independent legislators, formed the government. A.K. Fazlul Haq became the first Prime Minister. Haq supported the League Lahore's resolution in the year 1940, which called an imperial government of the British India to include the eastern zone of the British India into a future sovereign homelands for the Muslims. The text of the resolution initially seems to support to have an independent state in Bengal and Assam.
Guys, today I am going to speak from the prospect of Dr. Shyama Prasad Enlightenment Federation. Today we are going to speak about the Shyama Prasad's political life and his history in Indian freedom. Abul Qasim Fazlul Haq, 26th October 1873, 27th April 1962, popularly known as Shere Bangla, Tiger of Bengal. He was a Bengal statesman and jurist who served as the Prime Minister of Bengal. Haq was first elected to the Bengal Legislative Council from Dhaka in 1913 and served on the council for almost 21 years until 1934. He was a member of the Central Legislative Assembly for 2 years between 1934 and 1936. For almost 10 years between 1937 and 1947, he was elected member of the Bengal Legislative Assembly, where he was a Prime Minister and leader of the House for almost 6 years.
Now, as we want to spread the die-hard contribution of Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee both before and after independence, so we need the help of our viewers to spread it to the general mass of India as much as possible, to bring out the ultimate truth and his devotion towards India as a nationalist hero. Now, as we have reached our research work to a far extent and we have lot of historical events, collected historical events from various sources, therefore we come to a perception, rather to a clear perception, that both A.K. Fazlul Haq and Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee had a closed match mental frequency. And by now, we think that our viewers has also perceived it too. Firstly, both of them had a strong educational background and they soulfully tried their level best to work for the general mass and especially for the backward class of the society. Therefore, both of them tried to work for the upliftment of the farmers, the fishermen, the workers, the cultivators, and so on. Secondly, neither of them had an intention to work for any particular religious section people, nor did they serve their own respective religious people. So they never differentiate among any religious section. Now it's crystal clear that both A.K. Fazlul Haq and Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee are purely non-communal person. Now today, we are going to enter into one of the darkest chapter of Indian history, the Great Bengal Famine of 1943, which surprisingly is never figured in our history textbooks. According to Hindi Jagrat Kendra, under the title Bengal Famine of 1943 and the Crime of Muslim League Ministry, dated 30 September 1997, Bengal became the bridgehead of British colonial intervention and expansion of India. It is paradoxical to note that Bengal was visited by two famines of serious magnitude, one in the year 1770 and the other one in the year 1943. While the famine of 1770 has been associated with the initial stage of British, and the Great Famine of Bengal 1943 looked like terminal disease of British imperial rule. Bankim Chandra Chatterjee, the prophet of Indian nationalism, wrote his celebrated novel Anandamot with the battle cry Vande Mataram in the context of the agony evoked by the ravages of the famine of 1770. Bengal famine 1943, where nearly 4 million people were killed because of the cruel, inhuman attitude of British President Winston Churchill. Now, unlike the other provinces of India, Bengal too had to undergo deep distress period of 1940s, which had a great wartime socio-economic impact, and it took a furious shape with the outbreak of the Great Famine of Bengal of 1943. Now, if you want to seek the root cause of this disaster, then number one, the worsening war situation in the Eastern Front. Number two, Japan's continuous interruption into Burma's occupation of the flow of rice import in India that led to a great deficit in the supply of rice in Indian market. Number three, the price of rice had doubled in 1942 from the pre-war level. Number 4. The unpredictable rise in the price of rice led to and was a result of unorganized and unchecked system of Bengal rice marketing. Number 5. According to recent books like Liberty or Death, India's Journey to Independence and Division, food supplies and transports were available for Holland, but no food grains for India. British politicians like Churchill starved India while still wanting it to use it as a base for its military operations. Number 6. Calcutta was given priority for the British, who desperately wanted to defend its imperial principles, and in order to feed Calcutta, that worsened the matter and situation more. as the needs of the districts were sacrificed.
So I'm going to start with this, what exactly happened at that point of time. So as you guys know, in the book Remembering Our Leaders, Bipin Chandra Pal, Anita Mahajan described the sterling efforts of Shyama Prasad Mukherjee in organizing the relief work. He saw to it that over 5,000 kitchens were opened in Bengal to cater to the needs of the famine-stricken people. He rose above narrow party alignments and in the process emerged as this shining example of Bengali protest against the British and the misleads of the Bengal government. By organizing the Bengal Relief Committee, Mukherjee raised cash donation of over rupees 27.5 lakhs and commodities value at rupees 10 lakhs. The Hindu Mahasabha also raised almost rupees 8.5 lakhs plus thousands of mounds of food grains. He travelled extensively across Bengal and also organized Bengal relief camps and many other services. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee's contribution to the Bengal famine was also acknowledged by President Venkat Raman for many, many years later. It is a pity that due to partition politics and distorted history, the giant of the man that was Mukherjee does not even find an honorable mention. So this is what exactly happened at this part of time.
Now today we are going to discuss about the political effects or the political crisis with the coming of the Bengal famine in the year 1943. Now, with the coming of famine in Bengal led to a political crisis in Bengal. Sir John Herbert, the governor of Bengal, dismissed A.K. Fazlul Haq on various means and followed under the new ministry of Nazimuddin, the Muslim League leader, with the help of the European legislators, which was installed on 24th of April 1943. And the Minister of the Civil Department, Subrawardi, ran the situation out of his control due to his coercive method. The Bengal famine situation affected the rural areas much more than the urban areas. Thus, among the 86 subdivisions of Bengal, 15 subdivisions with about 15 million of people were affected immensely. And as the rural areas were much more affected, so there were immense increase in destitute migrants in Calcutta. Thus, the process of these destitute migrants began in July 1943. Devastating cyclone and tidal waves that wiped off the coastal region. But the relief efforts were hindered due to bureaucratic interference. On 3rd August, many prisoners were shot dead in Dhaka jail. Again, due to bureaucratic, there were no inquiry on it. Now coming to 9th of August, when the Congress launched the Quit India movement, which was followed by the British political repression, caused another severe strain on the administration. Now the entire province were repeatedly echoed with protest. Further, the complication raised to its height when Mukherjee resigned, complaining by the fact of the interference of the governor in the work of the ministry. However, the allegations were not so kindly taken by the governor, and largely due to his initiative, non-confidence motions were voted in the assembly on March 24 and March 27. Although by narrow margins, the motions were defeated on both occasions. To enforce his writ, the governor asked Huck to sign a prepared letter of resignation on 28 March 1943 and assigned himself the responsibility of administering the province under the provision section 92 of the constitution. A month later, a league-dominated ministry was commissioned with Nizamuddin as the prime minister.
The new study says that the Bengal famine of 1943, estimated to have killed up to 3 million people, was not caused by drought, but instead was a result of a complete policy failure of the British Prime Minister, that was Winston Churchill. So he was one of the British Governor General. The study, published in the journal Geophysical Research Letters, provided scientific backing for arguments that Churchill's policy played a significant role in contributing to the 1943 catastrophe. Covering the years in 1870 to 216, the researchers analyzed a soil moisture database to reconstruct agriculture droughts. The research studied six major famines in the subcontinent between 1873 and 1943 and concluded that the Bengal famine was the only famine that does not appear to be linked directly to soil moisture defect and a crop failures. The idea was to study the history of drought and famines in India and the factors responsible. That was said by Vimal Mishra, the lead researcher and as an associate professor at the Indian Institute of Technology, Gandhinagar. Aside from the 1943 Bengal famine, all the other famines between 1870 to 2016 appear to be related at least in part to widespread soil moisture drought. But the 1943 Bengal famine was not caused by drought, but rather was a result of a complete policy failure during the British era. He told Al Jazeera this was the only famine that does not appear to be linked directly to soil moisture, drought and crop failures, Mishra said. Youngest generation don't know about the contribution of Dr. Mukherjee in the freedom movement. This is not the mistake of the generation. However, in history books has never mentioned about the contribution of Dr. Mukherjee's. The Congress government never gave recognition as he deserves. He joined the Hindu Mahasabha in 1939 and he became a president in 1944. When the famine of Bengal arrived in 1943, organized a large scale of relief work. When N.A., that was Muhammad Jinnah, introduced the two-nation theory by dividing India and creating Pakistan, Mr. Mukherjee opposed with tooth and nail. So this was basically the conclusion. That means again, you can know right that how this history things has actually played, because this books never mentioned what exactly his contribution was there during this Indian freedom movement, and that's the reason why the younger generation doesn't know that what kind of contribution he did.
Now, we have already gone through Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee's early age up to his contributions in the Great Bengal Famine of 1943. So, before moving to the dips, ups and downs and journey of Mukherjee's life, let's have a look into the year from 1942 to 1946 of Shyama Prasad Mukherjee's role in political phase of India. And today, we will have a brief concept of Shyama Prasad Mukherjee's political role in the year 1942 and the Quit India movement. So, Shyama Prasad established himself as the most towering leader of Bengal in a matter of only 6 to 7 years and then quickly attracted limelight in all India politics and emerged as arguably the most important opposition voice in parliament in independent India. Now, his crusade during the Bengal famine to serve and save lakhs of victims of famine in 1943 must set at rest any doubt on this issue. While Muslim League ministry operated in a nexus with the British regime, creating and festering this dangerous famine, which devoured nearly 3.5 million lives of Hindus and Muslims, Shyama Prasad worked tirelessly to raise resources, serve and save as many lives as possible.
Opposition to Quit India movement, Hindu Mahasabha's official decision to boycott the Quit India movement, and the Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh's decision of non-participation in the movement, as Gandhi wanted British government to transfer his entire power to the Muslim League. Mukherjee wrote a letter to Sir John Herbert, Governor of Bengal, as to how they should respond to Quit India movement. In this letter, dated 26th of July 1942, he wrote, "Let me now refer to the situation that may be created in the province as a result of any widespread movement launched by the Congress. Anybody who during the war plans to stir up mass feeling resulting internal disturbances or insecurity must be resisted by any government that may function for the time being." Mukherjee in this letter reiterated that the Fazlul Haq led Bengal government along with his alliance partner Hindu Mahasabha would make every possible effort to defeat the Quit India movement in the province of Bengal and made a concrete proposal in regard to this. Now, continuing to the political phase of Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee's life between the year 1942 to 1943, we are here to know that considering the short time span, that is 1940 to 1953, in mainstream politics, he was no doubt one of the most impactful politicians. His detractors have been fearful of his powerful thoughts and ideas. With the support of political regimes at the center and state of West Bengal, they engineered several layers of misinformation about Shyama Prasad Mukherjee and his legacy. The apparent purpose of such dishonest enterprise
has been to wage kind of mental blocks between his ideology and the masses. Four examples show such misinformation campaign. First, Shyamaprasad Mukherjee was accused of joining hands with Communal Muslim League and forming a ministry in Bengal. Second, he was projected as a pro-British and anti-freedom struggle. Third, he was condemned for helping the British by repressing the activists of Quit India movement. Fourth, he was held out to be anti-Muslim. First, Shyamaprasad never joined hands with Muslim League to form a ministry, but he had, in a political blitzkrieg, snatched away Fazlul Haq and Haq's followers from the clutch of Muslim League and substituted the League-led communal ministry with a multi-party secular government. This was the first and the only secular ministry since 1937 in pre-independence Bengal.
Bengali Hindus have a homeland today in the form of West Bengal. It is all due to Dr. Shyamaprasad Mukherjee, the founder of the Bharatiya Jana Sangha. Though Mukherjee was vehemently opposed to the partition of India as demanded by Muhammad Ali Jinnah and his All India Muslim League, when he realized that partition was inevitable, he prevented the whole of Bengal province, East and West Bengal, from going to Pakistan. It was due to his effort that the Bengali Hindu homeland movement could successfully lobby for the partition of Bengal and ensure a safe homeland for Bengali Hindus.
Second, Shyamaprasad was a fierce advocate of freedom and favored constitutional path as a preferred method. Like Congress demanded of national government, failing which it called the Quit India movement, Shyamaprasad also demanded the national government and spoke powerfully on this issue. He consistently attacked the British regime, challenging that it had no moral and civilizational legitimacy to govern India, and demanded transfer power without delay. His letters, more particularly his resignation, dated November 1942, and his later writings in the Nationalist reveals his thoughts and ideas on this issue unequivocally. Third, Shyamaprasad, like other leaders of stature like B.R. Ambedkar, C. Raja Gopalachari and organization across the spectrum, did not support the Congress decision of launching Quit India movement. It was likely to lead to chaos and anarchy and attract brutal repression by the British. However, he was in sympathy with the activists and supporters of the movement who faced British brutalities. Correspondence between Viceroys and Secretary of State showed that British Governor Herbert Anderson had gone in doubt that Fazlul Haq was under the influence of Shyamaprasad and his ministry would not implement British policy of oppression against the Quit India activists in Bengal. In these circumstances, Governor Herbert had let loose brutal repression through the policy and military on people of Midnapore who were simultaneously ravaged by natural calamities and food shortage. He did this using permanent officials by setting aside repeated objections by Shyamaprasad cabinet. Shyamaprasad's letter of resignation referred to earlier should leave no one in doubt about the British hand in Midnapore atrocities. When the governor still refused to mend his ways, Shyamaprasad had resigned from the cabinet. Midnapore atrocities were one of the key reasons. Even after resigning, he did not let the governor off the hook. in February 1943. He ensured that the Home Ministry agreed for an inquiry into the alleged atrocities in Midnapore. This was a slap on the face of the governor. Fourth, very often his detractors seek to attach the anti-Muslim label to his persona, hoping it will somehow manage to stick. Facts expose this mischief. Several Muslim ministers in the Shyama Huck cabinet trusted and respected him. Bengal Premier Fazlul Huck used to hold him in high esteem. One indeed goes farther than Shyama Prasad's address on February 12, 1943, explaining the resignation to the Bengal Legislative Assembly to understand the kind of rapport he had with all communities. It was his legislatures and commoners that made some Muslim leaders charge him for having divided the Muslims. Finally, we revert to
for partition of India, on his hate for the partition of Bengal. If 35% of Muslims cannot live in India with 62% Hindus, there was no way that 32% Hindus can stay in a Bengal with 54% of Muslims, asserted Mukherjee. It is said that when Jinnah lamented the loss of West Bengal to Mountbatten, the latter pointed out that Mukherjee had paid Jinnah back in his own coin. Jinnah's arguments for partition of India to create a separate homeland for Muslims was used by Mukherjee to make a strong case for a separate homeland for Bengali Muslims.
The British were forced to annul the partition in 1911. But more games were being played by the British to subdue the Bengali Hindus. The Indian Councils Act of 1909 was passed and formed the basis of the Government of India Act 1919, through which proportional representation along communal lines was introduced, and Bengali Muslims were awarded more seats in the Bengal Legislative Council than Bengali Hindus.
Mukherjee also won over jurists of Calcutta High Court to support the movement, and nearly all the Bengali Hindu lawyers signed a petition demanding the partition of Bengal. Hindu business people and Chamber of Commerce, including the legendary Ghanshyam Das Birla, also rooted for the demand. Mukherjee efforts gave results, and on June 3rd, Lord Mountbatten declared that Bengal would be partitioned. On 20th June 1947, all legislatures of Bengal Legislative Assembly from Hindu majority areas of the province voted for the partition of Bengal and creation a separate homeland of Bengali Hindus. Thus, West Bengal was formed.
Now, out of the 144 seats in the council, 46 seats were kept reserved for Bengali Muslims, while Bengali Hindus were awarded with 39 seats. The rest were for institutions, Europeans, Anglo-Indians and others.
Mukherjee roped in the media, including leading newspapers of those times like Dainik Basumati, The Statesman, Amrita Bajar Patrika and others to campaign for partition of Bengal. He was instrumental in securing support from leading intellectuals like Meghnath Saha, Jyotirinath Sarkar, Ramesh Chandra Majumdar, Suniti Kumar Chatterjee and others to lend their weights to the partition of demand. Mukherjee convinced the Congress to hold a joint public rally with the Hindu Mahasabha to demand the partition of Bengal. The rally held on 7th of May in Calcutta and presided over by Jyotirinath Sarkar delivered a major boost to the partition movement.
So today I'm going to talk about what exactly happened at that part of time. So earlier, however, Haq had moved the Lahore resolution at the Lahore session of the All India Muslim League in March 1940, calling for the establishment of independent states for Muslim in the northern, western and eastern parts of British India. This became the bias for the creation of Pakistan. When his ministry fell in 1941, he sought the support of the Akhil Bharatiya Hindu Mahasabha, headed then by Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, and a breakaway faction of the Congress led by Sarat Chandra Bose, elder brother of Subhash Chandra Bose. Sarat Bose and many other Bengali Hindus had broken away from the Congress after Subhash Bose was forced to resign as president of the Indian National Congress by Gandhiji and his colleague in 1939. The Progressive Coalition Ministry headed by Haq with Mukherjee as Finance Minister assumed office in December 1941 and functioned till March 1943. Haq was succeeded by Muslim League Khwaja Nazimuddin, a section of the Dhaka royal family, who reigned till March 1945. It was during his tenure that the infamous Bengal famine of 1943, which took the life of more than 3 million people, occurred. The provincial government acted in the high Persian manner, providing relief to Muslims and ignoring Hindus. Mukherjee and other Hindu Mahasabha leaders protested vigorously against this. After World War II, elections were held in leaders protested in 1946, and the Muslim League won 113 seats in the 215 member assembly, and they formed the government with H.S. Shirvadi as the Prime Minister in April 19.
Mukherjee and leaders of the Hindu Mahasabha and Bengal Congress lobbied successfully for retaining Calcutta within India. They also successfully defeated a diabolical plan hatched by Surabardi for an independent and united Bengal. Surabardi and other Muslim leaders were alarmed that Hindu-majority Calcutta, with all its academic and financial institutions, as well as Hindu-majority western part of Bengal province that had almost all industrial units and factories, the Calcutta port and other infrastructure would go into the hands of Hindus and Muslims would be left with the poorer and lesser developed eastern part of Bengal.
Now, as we want to spread the die-hard contribution of Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee both before and after independence. So we need the help of our viewers to spread it to the general mass of India as much as possible, to bring out the ultimate truth and his devotion towards India as a nationalist hero.
Giving vent to the fear of the Muslim League, its leader, ex-congressman Muhammad Ali Jinnah, called a press conference at his Mumbai residence in July 1946 to announce that the Muslim League had chalked out a plan to launch a struggle for achieving their demand of an independent state. "We'll either have a divided India or a destroyed India," Jinnah stated. One of the first steps towards the said struggle was calling of a general strike on 16th of August 1946 and termed it a direct action day. 16th August was cleverly chosen by Jinnah as that it was the 18th day of Ramzan, the day of Prophet Muhammad was for the fierce battle in Badr, defeating the non-believers and conquering Makkah. Hence, it was a significant day for the Islamists and was an indirect call by Jinnah to repeat their triumph over the Hathians. This call is itself established Jinnah as a bigot far removed from the polished, elitist image of he used to carry earlier on.
Direct Action Day, 16th of August 1946, also known as the 1946 Calcutta Killings, was a day of widespread communal rioting announced by Jinnah that incited violence between Muslims and Hindus in the city of Calcutta in the Bengal province of British India. The day also marked the start of what is known as the Week of the Long Knives.
In Bengal was a little bit complex, as the total population was divided mainly in between the Hindus and the Muslims. The Muslims were in 54% over here and the Hindus were in 44%. The main concentration of the Muslims were in the eastern part of the state, which is now the Bangladesh, and then it was ruled by a provincial autonomous government which was formed in the year of 1935. And that was also in the face of the strong opposition from the Indian National Congress and the Hindu Mahasabha. This Hindu Mahasabha was constituted mainly by the people from Rajasthan who were known as the Marwaris.
A massacre was probably not the League's goal, although one pamphlet circulating amongst Muslims warned of a general massacre of Kafirs, infidels, that is Hindus. But the League supporters did not shrink from using violence on a significant scale to advance their objectives. Although the use of violence by a minority against the majority could appear irrational to us, in the mindset of many Muslims at the time it was not so, because they considered the Hindus cowardly and effeminate and thought they were no match for Muslims in an open fight. As for the Hindu political parties, both Congress and the Mahasabha were bent on making a counter demonstration of their superior muscle power. Therefore, they were not adverse to large-scale killings to decisively defeat the Muslim League's attempts to impose its dominance. The massacre was the result of the clash of two wills, between which no compromise was possible.
this horrific situation, when the situation got a little bit subdued, the great Gandhi came to Calcutta. And to our surprise, in our days when I see that these are some kind of massacre done by a certain community, certain religious community, surprisingly, he only asked Hindus to put down their arms. One of the journalists at that point in time, Shailen Chatterjee, said that people with shabby dresses, with country-made pistols and daggers, came across so many these places and they have put their arms and ammunition on the feet of Mahatma. This was really a very horrific and miraculous situation, and that might be one of the reasons that even Lord Mountbatten told that this was the miracle of Gandhi. But was it a miracle? Because in this specific situation, not a single Muslim were told to put down their guns, and they kept their hatred towards the Hindus as it was initially. Was it a miracle, or was it a certain kind of barter which was completely unacceptable at that point?
Thank you all for watching our video and supporting us with so much of love. As you all have seen that we are continuing on with the Great Calcutta Killing episodes. And after completing this phase of Great Calcutta Killings, we will move to some more rides grade-wise as Noakhali rides and likewise. We will continue with our national icon Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, his role in all these riots and pre and post independence of India, ultimately to his sacrifice and death. All this will remain as a research work for all of you, and in period of time, more and more people to come as well as generation will get to know it about our national icon Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee. Thank you. Namaskar. Jai Hind.